your access code, followed by the pound or hash. To enable audio controls, please enter your audio.
Hi everyone, this is Sam here. So I see 7 attendees, so you can go ahead and start. Sharing my screen. Okay, the recording is on. So the first thing, guys, I want to say sorry to you all. I couldn't get the assignment ready. Actually, I started preparing the assignment, but my kid wasn't well since last night. Since yesterday evening, actually. He's suffering from cold and I had to take care of it, so assignment, I couldn't prepare it. So mostly I'll be prepared, getting it done today evening or tomorrow. I'll be sending out to you guys. That's about the assignment. And recordings, yeah, I still have to work on them. I just spoke to this person from Texara, and yeah, we are working on it to edit all the recordings and provide you guys. I can assure you guys that by the time your training is done, by the time we finish the developer part, we will have all the recordings with you guys. So, and before starting developer training, let me tell you a few things. So, in this complete training, NetSuite training, whatever you see in admin tasks, those are as it is you'll be getting. Like, those are the features. So it's easy. Like, if you get a project and you go and join tomorrow, what all you've seen in the admin training, using that knowledge, you can survive, you can manage. But when coming to developer part, okay, we are going to start developing developer sessions today, and we're going to see what all developer features are present, what all scripts are present, when are they used, how are they used, how are they written. You can see all that. But even assignments, I'm not going to give you any assignments on developer part because it's not easy. Even after taking developer training 3-4 times, even then, if I give you any assignment on developer part, any script to write, any script, it's not easy. So you might ask, okay, when will we be ready to write a script? Once you get onto a project, and on a project, nobody will ask you to write a script within 1 hour or on the same day. Then if they ask you to write a script on the same day, you can always manage. You can say, okay, I'm still writing on it. I'm still getting some errors. I need to fix it. I'll get it done by early tomorrow morning, and then in the evening you can come home and sit with your support and get that done, learn with him. So only once you get live requirements for scripting and your support writes those scripts and shows it to you, shares it with you and explains you how it's written, what is the structure, what's happening, only by that real experience you will learn scripting. Okay, that's where you'll certainly learn scripting. Even it takes time for each individual. Some of you might learn within 3 months, some might take 6 months, some might take even a year to learn scripting. Learning scripting in sense, you stop support and you start scripting yourself. In that sense I'm saying. So it might take some time, but the initiation of learning it, to know okay how it is written, you certainly get it only once you get into the project and get the requirement and your support is doing it. So what will we do now? It's like you can say, okay, then we don't need any developer training, you can just go and see what support is. But when you take the interview calls, you might say proxy might be taking the interview calls, but proxy won't be taking your vendor calls. You should be taking your vendor calls. Proxy will be taking only the client calls. So when you talk to vendor calls, so suppose a vendor has at least basic knowledge on NetSuite, he might ask you any question on scripting. So to counter that, to answer those questions to vendor, and also once you get onto a project, you'll manage 8 hours using admin tasks, you'll come home and get it done with the support. But what if someone asks you any question in developer part? That may be a basic question. Forget it if it's a difficult, complex question. Then certainly you'll say, I need to look into it. I doubt whether I've worked with, I came across such scenario or situation or not. So you can manage that. But if it's a simple, basic question someone asks you in scripting, then if you say I look into it, then you're caught, right? Red-handed over there itself. So to counter those things, okay, so that you can manage when someone asks you a basic question on your on-site at work, or to take vendor calls, or for suppose you are very unlucky and you don't get a proxy for a client call and you have no other option, but you yourself will go and take client call. It will happen. And don't think that, okay, if I take client call, it's already a gone case. I may not get the contact. Don't think like that. There are some, not, it's not lucky. There are like some people, if you work hard, if you are listening to the training very hard, and if you are dedicated, you are trying, you are practicing something, and you're, whatever you are listening, you are trying to remember it, then certainly even if you take the client call, you will, you can crack it. Some of you guys might have done it. Some of you have done it. I don't want to take the name. I don't want to make someone a hero, but there's a guy sitting in within this meeting. He has taken a call himself and he has cracked the client call. He got it. And there is one guy who has even went face to face with a client and he got the project. He has no experience in NetSuite, but still he got the project. See, these sort of things do happen. So you may have to take a client call in some rare situation in order to counter that. So if you go through this developer training, you'll get to know, okay, what all scripts are there, when do they trigger, when do they, what do they perform. You can, it helps you when you take those client calls, certainly in the vendor calls, and certainly when someone asks you a basic question at your work. So that's why I'm giving you an early insight, like what to expect, what not to expect from this training. So let's start a developer training. So there are two things in developer training. One is writing scripts, one is writing a workflow, creating a workflow. Okay. Writing scripts is the main part. I'm sharing my script, fine, okay. If you come to customization, scripting, and script, this is the part, okay? And even script deployment, scripted records also come under scripting, okay? And then schedule, script, status, yeah, even these all statuses too. So these are all under scripting, okay? All this. And workflows is this over here. So what is the difference between workflow and scripts? Workflows are limited. Scripts has more capability than workflows. Workflows might look very easy to create a workflow. Script might be little difficult to write a script, to write all the coding. But scripts are always effective. You can always trust on scripts. I'm not saying workflow doesn't work, but workflows do work, but they have limited capability. For example, what do we have here? Do you have any invoices in the recent records? Okay, we have sales order. So here we have a sales order. If you write a script on sales order, you can it can perform on both header level fields as well as your column fields. You can see here, column fields are your nothing but your items. Okay, these are all your column fields. Okay, but a workflow can only perform on header level fields. Workflows don't work on column fields. So, but most of your ERPs around transactions and JEs, and there are columns in transactions and JEs. And if workflows can't work, can't perform anything, can't do anything on this line level, that's it. That itself shows that workflows are not that efficient, not that capable. Their scope is limited, to put it in simple words. So the scope of scripts is vast compared to workflows. So that's the difference. We'll get to see what are workflows too later on, but first let's look into scripting. What are different kinds of scripts we have in NetSuite and what do they do? So customization, scripting, scripts. Don't click on no. Let's go to scripts and see. So if you do filter over here, you have type. Okay, these are the script types. What are script types we have? Okay, these are all the script types we have. Suitelet, restlet, user event, scheduled, client, portlet, mass update. If you have a book and pen, you can make a note of it, or else if you want to just remember, okay, you can listen carefully and remember what each one of them does. I'm not looking at help, I'm just letting you know what all I know, okay? Okay, let's see Suitelet. What is Suitelet? Suitelet is if you create a button and you want to put something behind the button, like some functionality behind the button, that is built in Suitelet, okay? And if you want a web page to be shown, that will be created in Suitelet. Like, you can create a URL, okay, and that you put two fields, and when someone clicks, and even to show that web page, you use Suitelet. Okay, Suitelet is nothing but showing web pages or behind the button functionality. Those all logic is present in Suitelet, okay. And Suitelet, it's deployed directly on anything. Like on button is on sales order, so you deploy directly on the sales order. Or else a Suitelet can also be called by some other script, okay? Like example, user event script can call a Suitelet script. It's like that. So Suitelet it can be deployed by itself on any record, or else it can even be called by some other kind of script, some other type of script. Okay. And then what is RESTlet? RESTlet, all I can say is sending data from NetSuite to any other application, any other third-party system. Like it can be a database, it can be any third-party application, any tool, any technology. So, and how is it done? Let me tell you frankly, I have built RESTlet only once in my life. I mean, in 5 years of my NetSuite experience, I built only once RESTlet. So RESTlet, what it does is, okay, you have a custom record here, your transaction data. When you need to send it to any third party, you need to get a credential, like, okay, the third party, give me the URL, give me your username, give me your password, and you hard code them inside your script, and then you send all your data to them. And over there, someone has to receive your data, and he has to perform again some work, okay, where the data goes. That's in RESTlet. And nowadays, why I didn't write a RESTlet in the past 4 years? I wrote only in the first year of my NetSuite experience. But after that, I didn't write a RESTlet because there are other ways of sending data to third parties. We have a Celigo integrator, which is over at setup integration. Celigo integrator. This sends data to third parties. Not only RESTlet, there's also one more script called schedule script. Even that can send data to third parties. So we have many other options. And also, nowadays clients are using integration tools like Boomi or some other tool. So that's why the use of RESTlet is getting reduced. If you come across any company that is still using RESTlet for an integration, that means they're not using advanced techniques, like they're not using any other applications. Okay, there might be some good reason. For example, they might be stingy, they don't want to spend on anything else. They don't want to spend on Celigo added to our NetSuite subscription. They don't want to spend on any integration tool. Their integration is limited, only few things they're sending out from NetSuite. So they don't want to spend money. Then fair enough, then they can use RESTlet. But it's very few because nowadays everybody wants to catch up with whatever is happening in the market. Everyone's using all new kinds of application technologies. And I don't know whether you guys have an idea or not. All these softwares, they cost in millions. The subscriptions are in millions. It may be NetSuite or Salesforce or even PeopleSoft, like Sexit or someone, or the person who's working on it. So even PeopleSoft. And all these integration tools like Celigo, okay, it may come for a very small price because it's already added into NetSuite. But Celigo has its own independent platform too. Even that will cost, that will be expensive. And also integration tools, even like Boomi, even that's expensive. So most of the, like NetSuite, for example, I know it costs $1 million, millions. NetSuite subscription itself is in millions. And integration tools, okay, it may cost in thousands of dollars, like $50,000 per 6 months or per month. So it's like that. So see, all these companies, they are willing, they are not hesitating to pay millions of dollars and take subscription of all these applications. So that's why, because they cost more, because all these softwares are expensive, there are very few clients who don't want to use all that, who doesn't want to spend. So they use RESTlet. And even if you fall in one of those client locations, you can still use schedule instead of RESTlet. I'll let you know how we do that. So RESTlet is for that, sending data from our NetSuite to third-party applications. Next, user event. What is user event? Okay, when you create a transaction, you are doing something, right? You are the user, you are creating. I mean, not only you, even the business user in your company, in your Honeycomb company, who are you, is working on that particular record. They are the user. So whatever they're doing on that instance, on that at that point of time, like they are saving, if they click save on a sales order at that point of time, okay, let's say user event. So user is triggering it. So whenever we trigger something, we save or we load or we update, at that point of time, if we want some functionality to be running behind some logic, then we use user event script. Okay, schedule script. What is schedule script? You want something to be done every day or every hour, every half an hour, you want something to be done and you don't want to interfere in it. So you write a schedule script. So schedule script, nothing but, okay, this script should run every day at this point of time. Fine, it will trigger that script. And what you'll put in that script, inside the script, okay, first you in most of the time schedule scripts start with the safe search. Okay, the criteria is okay. These are the JEEs we want. We'll put the criteria. We want to. We'll get the JEEs in the results and go to each and every JEE and approve it. So it's that kind of logic we use. That kind of functionality we use. So that's how. That's where schedule scripts are used. All your logic, it should be executing at a particular schedule. So for that we use schedule scripts. And then client script. What are client scripts? It's all validations on a particular form. Okay, if any form, sales order, customer, or employee, or invoice, any form. We want any validations on the form. So then you use client script for all kinds of validations, all kinds of sourcing. You know, I've shown you sourcing, right? When you click on the field definition record, we have sourcing, right? We okay, on that record itself, there is any other record. For example, on invoice, if we have a customer. Okay, from customer record, we want some field on the invoice, then we do sourcing, right? So even the sourcing can be done in client script. There is a function for that. So all the validations are done in client script. And then portlet. What is portlet? I told you about portlet. On the dashboard, you build a small kind of form where you have few fields and you click give a submit button. So creating that form is portlet. So from portlet, you can create dashboards for any user, custom dashboards. You create you give a name, you provide some fields, you provide some values to the fields, then you provide a button, submit button, and then finally you say, hey, when you click submit button, call this Suitlet script. Suitlet script will have the logic for that button. So it's like that. So that's why we use Portlet script. And then mass update. What is mass update script? When you have a custom record, okay, and you want to delete all the things in custom record. For example, your customization, record types, you may have any custom record with lot of records. Let's say if what do we have here? A bus test record? No, I don't think he might have a few. So let's see all these locked ones. It has only one. So if, for example, you have a custom record, okay, and it has thousands of records. Okay, for instance, let's open this bus test record. Oh, he has only one. Great. So is there any record where we can see quite a few? Last 10 marks. Wow. Okay. We'll open this. See, we have 10 records. Okay. For example, you may have 100 records, 1000 records. It depends. It varies. So, if you want to delete all these records, okay, you can't keep on going. Here, there are 10. Okay, fine. You'll go to each and every edit, delete. Or else, even here, you can do. See, you click on edit and you'll get here. You go delete record. Okay. And this is one more option. So, you'll go to each and every record. But if there are thousands of records, will you keep going to each and every of those and click delete? It takes time. No, you can't do that. So that's why. Or else you have any criteria. Okay, your criteria, you want to delete those records which has an alphabet H on its in the name. So that criteria, you need to look into each and every name and then delete it. So in those scenarios, those situations, we use mass update script. Okay, that's when we deploy the mass update script on the custom record, and we put some logic criteria, and based upon the criteria we delete all those records. So that's when you use mass update script. And then workflow action. What is workflow action script? Apart from scripts, we have workflows too, right? So in workflows, if there's a lot of things to be done on a sales order, like for example, if we deployed a workflow on a sales order, and mind you, it's only it only works on header level, it doesn't work on line level. But someone might say, no, from this workflow, do something, but we want this functionality to be implemented on the line level too. Then what will you do? Oh, workflows can't do anything on line level. But this guy says, you need to do. How will you do? Then from workflow, you call this workflow action script. And you put all the logic for the line level inside this workflow action script. And see, when I say scripts are preferable than workflow, it's like you're directly building a script and that will execute. See, when a workflow calls a workflow action script, it's like you have to build a workflow, and if the workflow needs some functionality on the line level, okay, you can make use of a workflow action script, but even you need to write the script for workflow action script, it's like all extra work. So that's why scripts are always preferred over workflows. And let me tell you even this one, in most of the client locations, you'll have a developer and administrator, okay? Developer, of course, he knows coding, scripting. So he prefers scripting. And he can even write workflows, no problem. So whatever administrator, admin can't do coding, he can't script. So administrator doesn't know how to do a script, how to write a script. But administrator knows how to write a workflow, because workflow is just creating, it's not coding, it's nothing to do with coding. So administrator will always prefer a workflow. But if the workflow needs to call a workflow action script, again the administrator has to come to us, developer, and say, hey, I built a workflow, but it needs some functionality on line level, so please write a workflow action script and I'll call from the workflow. So that's when workflow action script will be built. And it's called workflow action script, you can't deploy it on any record. It should always be called from the workflow. Okay? And workflow will be deployed on any record. And then bundle installation. What is bundle installation? No one uses bundle installation. Let's see if we have. See, only, okay, whenever this extra bundles we have, like extra functionality, extra NetSuite bundles that we install, only those bundles use this bundle installation scripts. So they're used for installing the bundle. So whatever we do here, like where is that? We go customization, suite bundler, and we create a bundle, right? So all that process can also be done from a script. But it's foolish to write a script instead of simply going and creating it step by step in the UI. So there is an option. So you can write a bundle installation script to create a bundle, or also install a bundle. But most of the times nobody uses bundle installation. No client uses, only when we have a bundle, when we have some functionality coming in a bundle, they use a script. They have a script. So don't worry, you will never be asked to write a bundle installation script. And then MapReduce, this is a new feature. This is very few new. Most of the clients don't use it. If you are unlucky, you'll see your clients using this MapReduce script. And I know one guy among you who is working at a client location, and that client uses MapReduce scripts. And MapReduce scripts, I have never worked on it, but as far as I've seen, it's similar to schedule script. Let's see what happens if we click on MapReduce. It's a painful process. Let it be. So if you want to know about MapReduce script, simple, go to help, MapReduce script, and get to know about it. So it's very less chance that you may be asked to build a MapReduce script. And remember this thing, if a client is using MapReduce scripts, either that script has come from a bundle, or that script has been implemented by NetSuite, or that script has been implemented by a person who learned SuiteScript 2.0. Now you will say, what is SuiteScript 2.0? Okay. So when you write a script, you are coding it, right? You write all the code. So that code currently, from the beginning of NetSuite started, from its initiation, that coding has been written in JavaScript, okay? Basic JavaScript. On top of it, NetSuite has its own APIs, like NL API. API starts with NL API, okay? NL API set field value, NL API get field value. So that's all called SuiteScript 1.0. So SuiteScript 1.0 is in use since NetSuite started till now, and it's still in use, okay? It's not like it's gone, it's still in use. Even when you go to a client location, and even in your interviews, if someone asks you, okay, have you worked on 2.0? No, you worked only on 1.0, okay? And even when you go to client location, he says, hey, do on 2.0. No, I worked only on 1.0. Never say to anybody that you worked on 2.0. Let me tell you about 2.0. What is 2.0? So NetSuite introduced its own kind of scripting called SuiteScript 2.0. Okay, even that's JavaScript, but it's like a newer, advanced version of JavaScript. Like in a new way you can write scripting. So NetSuite introduced it in 2015. So it's just last year. Okay, just last year NetSuite introduced it 2.0. And what's happening is NetSuite says in 2-3 years we want everybody to be working on 2.0. But the thing is, nobody knows 2.0, how to write on 2.0. So NetSuite itself is giving training, and obviously it's not for free. They will charge, they'll take fee, and they provide training. So if you come across any client using a 2.0, it's implemented by NetSuite or coming from a bundle or built by a person who took training from NetSuite. Okay, so that's the reason. if any client or vendor or at your project site, if they ask you, hey, why don't you build on 2.0? You should say, I have been working on NetSuite since 4 years, or whatever years you put in your resume. Okay, I've been working since 4 years in NetSuite, and since 4 years I've been working on 1.0. And when did 2.0 came in picture? It came in 2015. And as soon as it came in 2015, nobody started using it because NetSuite didn't provide training in 2015. They started providing, as far as I know, they started providing in 2016. So currently NetSuite is giving training for that. So you should say they just started giving training. Just within 1 year they started giving training. So I haven't taken the training. And also you can raise up a point. Any company will not provide training to a consultant. They will provide training only to their full-time employee. And I being a consultant, there's very less chance that a client will get me, provide me training in NetSuite. So you that should be your backup point, that I've worked only on 1.0 since 4 years, and 2.0 is recently introduced by NetSuite. For that, we need to get training from NetSuite, and I haven't got training from NetSuite. If you get me training from NetSuite, certainly I will learn and I will work on it. That should be your attitude. You should say, I'm not complaining that I will never work it. No, I haven't worked. I don't want to work. It's not like that. Since nobody gave me training, I never worked on it, so I can't work on it. You give me any requirement, I'll work on 1.0. If you want me to work on 2.0, fine. Give me the training. I'll learn. I'll go to the training and I'll start working on it. Or else even if you have documents which completely explains how to do the scripting, give it to me. I'll go through documents. I'll learn. I'll do. Nobody will waste time on giving you document and you going and learning them and start working. Nobody will waste time on such time on contractors. So that they won't take that option certainly. So they'll have only two options, either to provide you training and then get you working on 2.0, or else just take it easy and get satisfied by you working on 1.0. So that's about 1.0 and 2.0. Okay. So MapReduce, it's been introduced with 2.0. That's the thing. So MapReduce is a new kind of scripting. So since you worked on 1.0 and not 2.0, you have never worked on MapReduce. But still, in your free time, just go to help and look into MapReduce. What is the type of scripting? What does it do? Okay. Do we have any other scripts? Yeah, these are the only scripts. So today, let's see client, and if time permits, user event. Okay. This order will follow. First, we'll see at client script, then we'll see at user event script, then we'll see suitlet, then we'll see scheduled. And then what else is left? These are the main scripts, okay? Make a note of this. Main scripts in this are client, user event, suitlet, schedule. These four are the main scripts. And then, okay, restlet, there's nothing. It's, as I told you, we need to get the credentials and send data to third party. Even there, someone has to receive data and work on it. So it's, you can say, I've built only once. This is how I built it. So I never worked on restlet. And don't worry that, okay, if I'm saying I didn't work on it, I might lose the job. It's nothing like that. If you are more honest, you have more chances of getting the project. Even at your work location. If you're more honest, it's better. Don't go to such extent that, oh, I'm a beginner. I just finished my master's. I don't know anything. I just took training and I can. Don't be such. Don't take your honesty to that extent. Just be honest that, okay, I didn't get this in my training. Our idiot trainer, Mr. Sam, hasn't taught us this point. So, okay, I haven't worked on this point. That keep your honesty level till that, okay? Tell them, okay, I haven't worked on map and reduce, or I haven't worked much on restlet. I've just used it once 4 years back. So I don't remember, I don't have any practice on that. So, okay, you can just say that. So our four are client, user event, suitlet, and schedule. That are four important. And after that, I'll let you know how to, what is a portlet, how it works, and mass update too, I'll let you know. We'll look into that. And workflow action, it's not required. I'll show you what is a workflow. Then from how a workflow calls a script, that we'll look into it. Then bundle installation, these two are not required. Take it easy. Okay, first look at client script. What do we have in client scripts? Now, are there any client scripts here? Does Honeycomb have any client scripts? Good, they have a lot of them. Okay, we'll see this one. This is being created by Prem. Good. So, one of us. So, what does client script do? If you get onto a script record, okay, this is called a script record, okay? On a script record, you'll see functions here. First, the first one will be the script file, So you write a script file, okay, now there, where will you write the script file? You can write in either Notepad++, okay? Your Notepad++ looks like this. I'll open a new, okay? Notepad++ looks like this, okay? You write a scripting here, you save it, and all scripts should be saved with .js, make that note. Right here, .js, okay. Every script file, when you name that script file, you name anything, okay. ABC script file name, maybe ABC, okay. ABC.js. Don't forget, it should always end with JS, okay. JS means JavaScript, so you should save all your scripts with JavaScript file. So, two ways of writing script, one is Notepad++. You can see here, download this, it's easy, it's free, and the other way is Eclipse. So, Eclipse is a software that you need to install. It's a pain installing that process. But one plus point in Eclipse is Eclipse can be connected to NetSuite. So you can connect your NetSuite account to Eclipse. Like in Eclipse, you have a place where you can go and give your NetSuite ID, password. Then it connects. And automatically, it will get connected to all the scripts. Okay. Then when you build a script in Eclipse, you save it. It will directly get loaded into documents, files, suite scripts. Okay. It will get loaded here. Then when you try to create a new script, you need not upload it from it from your desktop. You just need to upload it from the file cabinet itself. So that's the difference. And if you say, okay, which one is best? In my 5 years of NetSuite experience, I've written all my coding in only Notepad++. Yes, sometimes my managers, my boss have said, no, use Eclipse. I said, okay, I'll use it, but I never used it. So only if it's mandatory, if you have a couple of other developers and they're all using Eclipse, then you have to use it. And if you think, okay, how to get installed? If no one is helping, what if I ask someone to help me install and he might think, oh, I don't know anything about NetSuite. So if you have that kind of worries, just go to help. And within help, you have the documentation how to install. It's called Eclipse IDE. See, downloading Eclipse IDE for use with SuiteCloud. That's it. So SuiteCloud is nothing but our next week, part dealing with scripts, okay? So you go through this and it will tell you what all you need to do. See, you have all the website and what file you need to download. So just download it and install it. So it takes time, it takes almost 1 hour to, it used to take 1 hour, I don't know nowadays how much time it is taking. So that's why it's a pain. And when you format your system, again you need to install it, go through it all. And for example, suppose if your system has been changed by your IT department, you get a new system, brand new system, again you have to install everything. So that's a pain. But the plus points of it is you can connect it to NetSuite and you can upload it easily. Even when you update your script in Eclipse, the update will be automatically uploaded into NetSuite, unlike Notepad++. Because Notepad++, it's all manual. You create your script, save it on your local drive with .js, and when you create a script, you have to upload it from your system, like over here. You say plus, and then choose file from your system. Okay, it goes to your computer, your local system, local drive, and you will select the file where you save it. Okay, that's how you upload. Even when you update, it's the same. Okay, now let's look at client scripts. Okay, what do we have in client scripts? These are all the functions. So any script, go. You'll first see the script file, and then you'll see the functions. So, client script has these functions. Okay, you might ask, okay, do we use all these functions? No, certainly not. And it's based upon your requirement. What kind of requirement your business user gives you? What does he want? What kind of validation he wants? Based upon that, you will select either of those. You may use one function or two functions or all functions. It's up to you, okay, based upon your requirement. So what are the common functions you use? If you ask me that, look at here. PageInit is a common function. Save record is common function, and validate field, validate change function, out of these two also you might use. And post sourcing, mostly you don't use post sourcing because it's already there on the field record. There you can put the sourcing. It's post sourcing, okay. After sourcing, what it's to that you can put. Yeah, so it's very rare you use this function. And line init, okay, on line level. See, we have line level functions too. Line initialization, validate the line, validate insert, validate delete. You won't use all this, okay? Validate insert, validate delete. Recalc, certainly you won't use this bottom three, for sure you won't use these functions. In rare case, if you want to use, you can use it. But if I'm not telling you about any function and you come across, okay, I need to use this, idiot Sam hasn't explained us how to do it, then you always have your help. Net should help. To, you can go there and you always have examples too. Let me show you. So let's do client scripts. Okay, so it gives client script. Okay, what is a client script? That will be the C. What is a client script? Okay. It says client scripts are used to validate user entered data and out to auto-populate fields or sublists at various form events. That's it. So you need to remember client scripts, what do they do? They use to validate user entered data and to auto-populate fields. That's it. Remember this thing, that's enough. So you are going to validate your data or auto-populate. You might think, okay, what is validate, what is auto-populate? I'll tell you. So you use a, you open any transaction. So what is validate? When you save the sales order and someone enters, okay, phone number, okay? If someone enters a 15-digit phone number, so you need to validate that. So what your script will do? The script will look at this field and say, hey, it should be only, the length should be only 10, not more than 10. That is your validation, okay? If it's more than 10, you might put through an alert message, or you might cut the last 5 digits, all those after 10 digits. That's all based upon your requirement, how you want to do, you can do that. So that is called validations, validating a field, okay? What is auto-populate? So when you create a sales order, oh, you can't create a sales order, so let's do the sales, create invoice, okay? So when you open a new fresh invoice form, see custom form is already auto-populated. Due date is already auto-populated, this is called auto-populated. Okay, these are standard fields, that's why it's auto-populated by default. Okay, let's see, okay, this invoice testing date, okay, this is a custom field. See, custom, so it's a custom field. So custom fields, if you want to auto-populate, you can do it from the script. And also you can do it at a field definition too. There is an option in the field definition. If you search, you'll find it. But if you want to, and over there it's only a static value you can, by default you can set it. But if you want any dynamic value, like dynamic in the sense it's changing, okay, different values. So if you want to set dynamic auto-populated value, then use this script, client scripts, okay? So for these two things we use client script. One is validating the fields, and one is auto-populating the fields, okay? Now let's see what are the, what does it say more about client scripts? Does it say anything about the functions? Client event types, let's see this. Does it have, yeah, see, we have all the functions. So, don't worry if I'm not scripting something, because I, as I told you, if I start coding something, you won't understand anything, any bit of it. So, scripting, it's better if you, once your support starts scripting and then you learn it, or else if you have free time, look at examples in help and try to understand. Okay, if we go much detail and firstly, if I start scripting and explaining it to you, firstly I need to give you Java training. I mean JavaScript training. So even that would take 15 days to 1 month. So we don't have the time. Even Texera doesn't give me time to go through all that. Texera says, hey, finish the training very fast. We need to market these guys and send these guys into projects, they need to earn as early as possible, so that's why. And don't worry, because even they know that if you go much detail, it doesn't. Okay, this is one basic thumb rule. However you practice, however you learn, however training you take, you can take NetSuite training or any application training hundreds of times. It's all different. Once you go to a project, once you are in live environment, it's completely, entirely different. Some of you might have worked before coming here, so you will know it better than other guys. So it's all different. It's completely different when you go there. Only thing is, okay, you do remember some things, okay. You get a requirement. Hey, auto-populate this. Okay, auto-populate. How can I auto-populate? Hey, client script does auto-populate. Yeah, Sam told us on the first development day, first session of development. Yeah, auto-populate client script does. So you'll get, so you'll just, at least you'll have an idea. Okay, client script does auto-populate. So it's like that. For that reason, we're going through all this. So let's see what functions do we have in client. Looks like we can't get into user event today. No problem. We'll speed up from tomorrow. So let's see all the functions of client script. What is page init? I'll tell you my explanation. Okay, page init is nothing but when you come onto any form. Okay. Okay, we just opened an invoice. Let's do this. Sales order. We are opening sales order. Okay. The page has just loaded. Okay. Page initialized, okay, it's called page init. Or you go to sales, you go to invoice, okay, Now invoice form has just opened. This is page init. Page initialized, okay? It's just simple language. Invoice page has been initialized just now. So that's why it's called page init. So over here, as soon as this is loaded, as soon as this is opened, you want something to work, you want some auto-population, you want some validation, you need to put your logic in page init function, okay? In page init function. You want to see an example? Yeah. You can spend 1 minute on seeing an example of page init. Look at this. Function page init, okay? You may not understand. Okay, let's see. Look at this one, okay? Okay, we also have this. Okay, set default values for a field, okay? He's doing auto-populate, okay? He's setting a default value for a field. Let's see what he's doing. So function, this is how you do scripting. Every time you start a script, all your scripts should be in a function, okay? Function, okay, page init is your function. It's not required that you give only all this, the same name. You can give any name, any custom name you can say. For example, okay, Prem, you can say function, Prem underscore page init. Okay, Prem underscore testing. Narsim underscore scripting. You can put any name, but make sure it makes sense. Don't use function, Sachin Tendulkar, function something else. That sounds stupid. So, unless if you're working in Honeycomb, okay, function Honeycomb underscore, where are you deploying the script? Okay, on JE record, journal record, okay, Honeycomb underscore JE underscore validation, or JE underscore auto populating. You can give such name to the function. Those make sense, okay? And then, this is commenting, okay? If you see two slashes, it means that line doesn't execute. It's just a comment. Okay, what is he commenting? If field A is either null or equal to value A, okay, that's his logic, okay? How is he executing? He says, this is a if statement in your scripting. If NLAPI get field value, that is your API to get the field value, okay? Field A, okay? Actually, you need to put an internal ID. This guy just has the field A as the internal ID over here, okay? Field A. So NLAPI get field value will get you the field value. The field value is Narasimha, okay? And what is it doing? Dot length. So Narasimha, length of Narasimha, how much is it? NARASIMHA, so it's 9, so length will be 9. So if the field length is equal to 0 or get field text, okay, it's directly getting the text value. Okay, now you might say, what is the difference? Okay, NLAPI get field value gets you the internal ID first. Okay, if it's a list by record, if it's a custom list, then you know, right, there's a custom list where we create, and for each list value there is an internal ID, so that ID will be returned. If you put NLAPI set field text, it will just give whatever text is there, whatever text is present. That's only for list by record. For example, you have date or you have freeform text. Okay, Narasimha, you are writing the name Narasimha in a freeform text. In that case, when you do NLAPI get field value, there's no internal ID for Narasimha, it's just the name you are entering. So, in that scenario, even if you use NLAPI get field value or even get field text, it will just return you Narasimha, that's it. Okay. When it will be different? Only if that value is from a list or a record which has internal ID. Okay. So even here the same thing. What is it doing? It's doing field A is equal to, okay, it's giving a value, okay, value A. So if this field has, field A is internal ID of a field, okay, that field has value, not Narasimha, it has value A, that's it, okay. Then if the length is equal to 0, no, Narasimha is not equal to 0. Value A is also not equal to 0, or if field get the text value. Text value, you can put Narasimha here, okay? Text value is Narasimha, then it will satisfy this condition, okay? So it's like that. This is OR. If you see two slashes, two straight lines, it's OR, okay? If you see two ampersands, it's AND, okay? So here the condition says if this field value length is equal to 0, or the field value, the text, okay, is equal to this, then do whatever is written, whatever is there in these brackets. So the condition should satisfy. So if is a condition, okay, this is an if condition. It should satisfy either of this. When there is OR, either this one should work or this one should work. So if either of those works, then whatever is there in this bracket will be executed. What is there? Set field text into field A. Value B. Okay, so what is doing is if a field value is, okay, how to explain this? Simple. Okay, this is a field, okay. If it has value VALUE. If it has value A, okay, what is it doing here? Where is the page? It's simply doing, okay, it gets, okay, get field value dot length equal to 0. Is length 0? No, it's not 0. We give value A. And then, okay, if the text is equal to value A, yes, it's equal to value A. Then it satisfies this condition. Okay, satisfied. Gets inside. NLAP has set field text. Okay, he's setting something. Okay, what is he setting? Into this field. He says, NLAP get field text value B. Get field text value B. So this is another field. Value B is another field, internal ID. So there might be another field. Let's see. Okay, sales rep, not sales rep. It does drop down. We need any, okay, dispute. Okay, dispute value, dispute internal ID might be value B. So what he's doing is getting the value from here and setting it on this. So it's that example. If you don't understand, whenever you have free time, just open this help, get into that client script, page in it, sample, you'll see this. Okay, you can try to understand it. And function page in it, there's one more example. Let's see this. Function page in it, okay, simple. What is it doing? There's no condition, okay. Is not giving any condition, it's directly doing something. What is it doing? NLAPI disable field. So disable means you can't enter anything in the field. You disabled, you can't enter a value. So what is it doing? This is the internal ID of the field which he's trying to disable. Okay, is it disabling or not? True. If he has true here, then he is disabling. If he has false, then it's not disabled. Okay, that's the parameter. You want to know how do we know the parameter? Go to help, just type NLAPI disable field. NLAPI disable field. Enter. Okay, it's not showing field APIs. Good. Go to field APIs. NLAPI disable field is the first API. Sets the field to disabled or enabled based on the value true or false. Okay. Are there any examples? No, there's no example. Okay, no problem. So that's what it does. Disable field, it enables or disables. What do you mean by enable disable? It allows you to either enter a value or it blocks from you entering a value. Okay. Now this is what happens in page init. Let's see other. What are the other functions in client scripts? Again, we need to go to the page. Client script type. Okay, let's go to type directly. This is not good. This takes up 2.0. Don't go to 2.0. Always get into 1.0, okay? So let's get into SuScript 1.0. Or let's just go and type again client script. Client script, the first one. And here we have event types. Okay, now here, we just look at page init, okay? So what page init does, whenever a page is just opened, you want some functionality to be performed. That's when you use this page init function and put your logic inside that. Okay. Then next one is save record. What is save record? It's simple. The name itself says when you save the record. So when you enter all your data and when you click on save, that's when this will be triggered. And all your logic, your criteria, whatever you are setting in the save record function will be executed when you click this save. Okay. Let's see an example. We have some time. Finish client script today. Save record example. Let's see one. Okay. See function save record. What is it doing? He again has a condition. If NLAP get field value. Okay. He's getting a field value. Dot length. Okay. Where is the string? Okay. Is string at the end. Okay. This is complete one. Okay. So he's taking the string. So when he's convert, what does he mean by string here? Is converting the value into a string. So string is nothing but any statement or any name, like Narasimha is a name, Sam is a name, Sachin Tendulkar is a name. So that's a string, okay? Or a sentence, even a sentence like Prem is a good boy, okay? Venkat is not a good boy. So it's a sentence, even that is a string, okay? So it's converting it into string. So whatever value is taking, whatever value is set in this field, okay, it should be a string. And what is the length of it? The length is 0. Okay. When will the length be 0? If there's nothing, only then the length will be 0, right? So if it's blank, only then it will be 0, right? Or else, even if you put A, the length will be 1, right? So the condition is, if the field is blank, obviously, if the field is blank, only then this condition will be satisfied. The length is 0. Then what is it doing? It's throwing an alert. Alert. Please provide a value for field A. See, because there is no value, he's saying, please provide a value for field A. And then he's saying return false. What does he mean by return false? Unless he provides a value, the script will not go further, or he can't move further on the form. That is the meaning of return false. You can take a note of it anyway. What do you mean by return false? Unless on what condition this return false has been thrown, unless you clear that condition, unless you clear that error or that wrong thing you have done, the script will not move further, you can't move further on the form. Okay? And if it is written true, fine. If it's written true, then okay, the script will go further, even whatever you are you want to do on the form, it will go further. You can do further. So when the length is equal to 0, when the field value is blank, it is throwing an alert saying, hey, provide field value. And or else if there's some value, okay, there's a field, it has a value called Sam. So there's a value. Then Sam is 3, length is 3, so it doesn't satisfy this condition. Then it comes down. If it satisfies, gets inside this. If it doesn't satisfy, proceeds after this block. So it comes here. Alert. Are you sure you want to save the record? It's asking you, are you sure you want to save this record? Then return true. That's it. It's an alert. So alert is nothing but it pops up a small message at the top over here. Over here you'll get a message box saying, hey, are you sure you want to save this record? You click on OK. Then that script will be script will proceed further, script will end, and then since you click the save button, even your invoice form will be submitted. Okay. So how do you put a script on invoice? You might get that question. Okay, we are writing scripts. How will you tell that script to, hey, you should work only on invoice, you should work only on sales order? That is defined on a script record. See, we have a script here. When you create a script, you provide a name, you can give a description, you give the script file, whichever function you want, whichever function is present in the script, you give here. There may be 5 functions in the script, you want only one to be executed, fine, you give that one. And that one, if it's a save, give it save under save. And don't forget, if you give a save function under page it won't work, it will throw an error. So whichever function it is written for, you need to write that, mention that function in that space. And then over deployments, okay, when you create a script, this is what you do on the first page, and then you come to deployments. So okay, this script you want on sales order, so here applies to sales order. Okay, you want the script on customer record, okay, fine, go here, applies to, you'll have all records here, all standard and custom records. See, even custom records here, Abbas test record. So standard, you want it on customer, okay, where is our customer record? See, there's customer, click on customer. And ID, if you want, you give, or else you don't give. Okay. Deployed, you should always have this deployed for the script to work. If you remove this, the script will not work. Okay. And then that should be always deployed. And testing, what is this status? If you put on testing, it will work only for you, I mean the owner. Okay. If you put on released, the script will run for everybody that's using Honeycomb NetSuite. Okay. And then event type, what is event type? In rare scenarios you use. Okay. Okay, you want the script to trigger only on copy, only on create of that record. There's customer here, right? Okay. Only on copy of customer or create of customer. Mostly we can, most of the times we mention that within the script. Only in rare, if you want to make use of this event type, you can select from here. And then log level. What is a log level? So in client script, you can't put logs. Except client script, each and every script, you can have logs. What do you mean by logs? What is the script doing? That's a log. For example, let's look at these examples. Okay, this is an example, right? We can put a log saying, hey, what is the value that came out of this field? You can put a log for that, so that we can see the logs. Where do we see the logs? Again, go back to script record, you have execution log. Over here, you see logs. If you want to see any current, let's do this. Let's go to list, leave this. Okay, let's go to any user event script, because except client script, all other scripts have logs. Okay, let's look at any scripts. Does any script have logs? I doubt. Frame, let's see, frame, user event sample. Does it have logs? No, it doesn't. So, even the logs, you can see the logs only for the present day. Okay. If you want to see logs of yesterday, you can do a search on the script, look at the script internal ID, and do a search on the script. And in the search, you can see execution log fields. And there you select the fields. You can select the criteria of execution log field, date should be yesterday's. And in the results, you want all execution log fields. Then you'll see yesterday's logs. Using search, you can get 30 days back logs, okay? All the logs of the script from last 30 days. Before 30 days, you won't get it, okay? using search. Without using search, if you just come to script and click on execution log, you'll see only the logs that are created today. Okay, only on this particular day of 9/8, September 8th. Okay, and if your time is 11:59, you are seeing the logs. So suddenly your logs will disappear, and you might be convinced, oh, what happened? Why did the logs get disappear? Because your time changed to 12, the date changed in the calendar. So only 12 in the night to 12 next night, you'll have the logs. You can see the logs. Okay. So what are in the logs? Whatever you put in the script, you can see here. What can you put in the script? So anything, like in the script, you are getting a field value. You can put that field value in the log. What it is, okay. So what it is, for example, you take a field value, okay. You put the field value in a variable. Okay, and take a variable ABC, okay. Variable is nothing but a temporary storage. It's just you store something at a particular location. That's called a variable. Okay, you are storing something into this variable called ABC. Its syntax is VAR and then the name. Okay, variable space ABC. Okay, we are creating a variable called ABC. And in that ABC, what are we storing? NL API get field 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 value. Okay, get field value. That's API. And now you need to put the internal ID in between. So let's get a field. Okay, we have invoicing. Okay, we get PO. Let's get this field value. This is internal ID. Copy this. Come to your script. Put this in between. And you need to close it. Okay, now the field value is in ABC. Now you can put a log. NL API. Log. Execution. Okay. And the first parameter should be debug. Okay, debug is where you are debugging. Debugging nothing but you are looking at your script. Okay, you want to see, you want to exact where, which point. Okay, what is the script doing at this point? So that's called debug. Always put debug. Instead of debugs, you can put error if you want to find an error. Okay, if there is error coming from ABC, error present in ABC, then you put error here. But you know this is not error. You just, you want to see what value is there. So it's debug. Always debug. Debug that, and then you give any title of this log. Okay, PO field value. Okay, PO field value, that's what you are getting in this log. Okay, and then the third parameter is your ABC. You should put this ABC. Okay, yep. This ABC will be here. So whatever variable you have, the variable should be the third parameter. Second is the title of the log. First is the log type is debug. Okay, log type, title of log, log value. Okay, log value is nothing but whatever is then variable ABC. So now what happens if you execute this? Since we have value A in this PO, okay, value A will be stored in ABC, and the log, this log will be showing us value A. So if I go to the script, it will show us, it will first give us the log title. I mean, it gives all the type. Okay, log type is debug, title, it gives the title is PO value, date, time, whoever is the user. In details, you'll see, okay, value A will be the details. So that is called looking at your logs, okay. And except client script, you can see logs for every other script. So you might say, hey, how to find logs for client script? How do I know what's happening in the client script? I told you there's alert, right? You can put alert. So how do you put alert? So simple. Over here, you say ALERT, alert. And inside, you again put ABC. Okay, I don't think you need that. So ABC, that's it. So what happens when the script executes this line? It comes to this line, alert ABC. It throws a pop-up saying, hey, it throws up a window, and in that window you'll have value A, because that's the value. But don't ever put alerts in production, okay? If you want, you can put in sandbox, that when you are testing, okay? For your testing, have alerts, you see what the script is doing. But if you give it for user testing, remove the alerts. And production, certainly never put alerts. Only if it's a part of the functionality. If the user says, hey, if this field is value is blank, throw an alert. That alert is fine. But you are having alerts to see what the script is doing. That's a different alert. Don't let the users see that. It's only for you when you are scripting and doing your developer testing. Okay. So that is about our save record. If we go back on this, does it go back? It's not going back. Good. So over here you can see, client search with examples. We don't want examples. We want to see the page. Okay, it's even types. So we've seen page init and save record. I'll quickly explain you what all they do. Validate field, whenever you enter a field value, or else it's already entered, but still you want to validate it. There is an invoice. On the invoice, there's a field. On that field, there's value. You want to validate that field, a field which is already entered. You want to validate it. You use this function. In that, you have your logic, Get the field value. If the field value is equal to NetSuite, then throw an alert or set the value to Salesforce or something based upon your logic. You can see this client event occurs when a field is about to be changed. Then it's about to be changed by user. So when it's valid field, it works. It works when a field is about to be changed by the user or by client side call. So that means you already have a field. Does it mean you already have a field? No. Whenever you're trying to change a field value, that means, there's a value in that field and you're trying to change the field value. Then this validate field executes and validates the field. And see, even this one looks same, field changed. Same thing. Here it says when a user is about to change the field, And there's also field change. What is this? What is the difference? Client event occurs when a field is changed by the user. Same thing, see? Here, this occurs whenever a field is about to be changed. Whenever a field is changed, see, there is slight difference. So when you are going and clicking on that field to change a value or to set a value, then this executes, validate field. And field changed, so when you give a value to a field, there's a blank field, you put a value called NetSuite. After you set the value, then this will execute. Or if there's a field called Sam, you go there, you change it to Narsimha, then this executes. After the field is changed, this field change executes. When the field is about to be changed, when you click on it to change it, this will execute. You might say, what is the difference? So you might have different functionality, right? There might be different scenarios. When your business user might ask, hey, someone wants to try to change this value, you throw him alert, hey, you can't change this field value. That's when you use validate field. Validate field, if the field name is this, that means the user is trying to change that field value, throw him, hey, you can't change this value, And field change, he can change it. And after changing, you want to throw him an alert. Then use field changed. After he set the value, Narsimha, then you'll throw an alert. Hey, you changed this field value. You should not change it. Take it back or clean it. Revert it back. So that might be your logic. So that's when you use field change. And post-sourcing. What is post-sourcing? This occurs following a field change after all the fields child fields are sourced from the server. So which means, as we already discussed, when we have a sales order, we have customer on it. We have customers, customers city on customer record. And then the sales order, we create a new field called customer city. Sales order customer city. So that sales order customer city, we are sourcing from the customer record. So once that sourcing is done, once you select customer and the customer value from the customer record, the city comes and is set on this city field on the sales order. After that, if you want some validation or some auto-population to be done, then you use post-sourcing function. Just whenever you have time, just look at post-sourcing examples. If most of you request me in email that, hey, you want to see a post-sourcing example, then tomorrow I'll spare some 5 minutes of time to look at the example. Then line it. What is line in it? So you go to invoice, you click on transaction sales, create invoice, line init, go by the name line initialization. So when you come here, items, this is a line. So when you're about to enter this, or when you select any field, this initialization, you are trying to select the line, you're accessing the line for the first time, you're initializing it. You're coming to the form directly, going to the line, go to any field, you're initializing the line. That's when, at the point, if you want to have any criteria, any logic to run, you're coming to a new invoice, you're trying to click on item, then if you want to throw an alert, then you should put on page, on line in it. As soon as you click on the line, you get an alert or something. As soon as you click on line, you want favorite color to be selected as black or red, you put that function, use that function on line in it, Just say set field value, favorite color and red. That's it. What else we have? Validate line. So when is validate line done? Once you enter all the values in the line, okay, whichever values you want to enter, and then you click on add. Okay, when you click on add, that's when this function will be triggered. When you click on add, the validate line, okay, you are validating. You enter the values in the line. Now it has to be validated. Now then this function triggers, and whatever logic you put inside that. For example, price is not mentioned. Okay, this is not mandatory. See, only location is mandatory. It has this asterisk. Price is not mandatory. Someone comes, selects an item, puts a location, clicks on add. Then you can put a script, client script, and validate line script. Inside that you will say, okay, get the value of price. If price is blank, then throw an alert. And when he enters these two values, clicks on add. Then your script triggers, looks at this field on price, it's not selected, throws an alert, hey, you didn't select. Or else on validate, you look at price, if price is not selected, you want the price to be $100. So your script does that. On validate line, it looks at the price, okay, price is blank, then set $100. That logic your script does. Based upon your logic, however the business user wants it to be, however your functionality needs it, you use that logic, okay. And what else we have in this? After validate line and line init. Where's this one? We want to get inside this. Okay. After line init, validate line, then we have recalc, validate insert. I told you won't be using this, but if you want, you can see what all this recalc. This event occurs after a sublist change. So what is sublist? Sublist nothing but, okay, we have RBK test. There's a sublist, okay? Here is a sublist. This sublist might be a custom record. It might be mostly a custom record, okay? So if something is changed in custom, in the sublist, only then recalc will be triggered. This event occurs after a sublist change, but only if the sublist change causes the total to change. Okay, see, that's one more thing. It's something. Oh, even you can call this a sublist. Even the line, even items, you can call these items a sublist. These lines, you can call them a sublist. If there's already an invoice created, you come on it, you click on edit, you come, you change the price, you save. You change the price, the total will be changing, right? There's a total over here. It's changing. So then if you want something to be done, you want some logic to be performed, then you use recalc function. Okay. Well, what is validate insert? Validate insert argument occurs when you insert a line into an edit sublist. So this is nothing but validate insert. So you already have an invoice, okay? It's not create, it's on edit. You already have an invoice, you click on edit, you scroll down, okay, there are two lines. You try to enter one more line, you try to add one more third line. That's when this will be triggered. Validate insert. Validate insert event occurs when you insert a line into an edit sublist. So there's always a sublist. There's already two lines in that invoice. You're trying to insert one more line, okay, into that invoice. That's when validate insert will trigger. And if you have logic in that, okay, when you're trying to insert, whatever the logic is present in this function, it will be executed. Validate delete, what is it? Validate delete event occurs when you try to remove an existing line from an edit sublist. Same thing, similar thing. So there's already an invoice, you click on edit. There are three lines, you try to delete a line, then this function will be triggered. It will not be triggered every time. If you have any script that has this validate delete function used, only then it will trigger. Okay, remember that in mind. Whenever you, for example, even field validate, if at all there's a script that is deployed on this form and it has field validate function, only then it will trigger. Okay, exactly. So we've seen all client script types. These are the client script function types. Okay, these are the different kinds of functions used by client script. So we'll just wrap up today till here, and tomorrow we'll look into user event scripts and files. Okay, so don't worry if you are not following. You'll get these recordings, and if you go to recordings, you'll hear whatever I said. Then you might get to know something, which will help you further in your projects. Okay, thanks guys. Thanks a lot. See you all tomorrow, and we'll proceed further tomorrow.
Thank you.
Yeah, thanks. Thank you. Yeah, good night to everyone. Bye.